Good morning and welcome to Geneva Presbyterian Church Online. I'm Pastor Joe Albright, and I want to say a very special word of welcome to any of you who are worshiping with us today as visitors virtually. We're delighted to have you. If you'd like to find a bulletin, there's a link right on the front page of our website. However, as usual, all of the words to the liturgy and songs are on the screen throughout our time of worship today. If you have prayer requests, you can also find a link right on the front page of our website. Our prayer team meets every Wednesday to be praying for you and any requests you might have. For those of you who are members of our church family, if you've not yet had a chance to fill out a pledge card for 2021, I'd invite you to do so this week. You can find a card again on the front page of our website. Or you can call Terry in the church office. Right now, our session is in the midst of budget planning and visioning for the year to come. And our commitments will help them to do so responsibly and faithfully. And on our part, they are indeed an act of worship. And now, my friends, this is a day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Please join me in the call to worship. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Let us worship God who loves us in this way.
Wealth of earth and pastures. shepherd, may I sing thy praise within thy house forever.
Realizing we are all in need of God's grace, let's turn our hearts to God as we join together in the litany of confession. In Jesus Christ, God broke the barrier of sin and pain which separates us from our neighbor, ourselves, and our God. We seek God's grace so we might move from alienation to new life. So, God, grant us new life in you. When we deny your presence in our busy days, O God, grant us new life in you. When we feel justified in our anger and resentment towards others, O God, grant us new life in you. When we judge others before looking at ourselves, O God, grant us new life in you. When we refuse to acknowledge our sin and our brokenness, O God, grant us new life in you. When we do not follow your will because we are fearful and untrusting, loving God, grant us new life in you. Hear now our silent prayers of confession. Through the waters of baptism that God's boundless grace is offered to us, God's mercy is sure and God's love is everlasting. There is more grace in God than there is sin in us. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Christ Jesus, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
This morning, we're going to continue our series of messages based on the parable of the prodigal son. But as we said last week, the focus of this parable is really on the father, a father who has two sons. And it's this second son, the older brother, that we're going to look at today. Once again, we're in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15. Now, in setting up this, we find Jesus hanging out with a disreputable group of tax collectors and sinners. And the Pharisees and scribes, who were the seriously religious folks of that day, they were complaining and grumbling about this. In their minds, they believed that by keeping the disreputable people out, they would preserve the integrity of their community. Now, in response to their grumbling, Jesus tells a series of three parables, all three dealing in God's grace. And it's this third parable that we come to again today, which really is a theological masterpiece. We're going to read verses 1 through 3 as a setup, and then we'll pick up in verse 11 through 32 to read the parable. Friends, listen now for God's word.
Today's scripture reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 15, with setup on 1 through 3, and then the main parable of the return of the prodigal son in 11 through 32. Hear now for the word of God. Dishonest tax collectors and other notorious sinners often came to listen to Jesus' sermons, but this caused complaints from the Jewish religious leaders and the experts on Jewish law because he was associating with such despicable people, even eating with them. So Jesus used this illustration. If you had 100 sheep and one of them strayed away and was lost in the wilderness, wouldn't you leave the 99 others to go and search for the lost one until you found it? To further illustrate the point, he told them this story. A man had two sons. When the younger told his father, "I want my share of your estate now, instead of waiting until you die," his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and took a trip to a distant land, and there wasted all his money on parties and prostitutes. About the time his money was gone, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him to feed his pigs. The boy became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding to the swine looked good to him, and no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "At home, even the hired men have food enough and to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired man.' So he returned home to his father, and while he was still a long distance away, his father saw him coming and was filled with loving pity and ran and embraced him and kissed him. His son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and you, and am not worthy of being called your son.' But his father said to the slaves, 'Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him, and a jeweled ring for his finger, and shoes, and kill the calf we have in the fattening pen. We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and has returned to life. He was lost and is found.' So the party began. Meanwhile, the older son, who was in the fields working, when he returned home, he heard dance music coming from the house, and he asked one of the servants what was going on. 'Oh, your brother is back,' he was told, 'and your father has killed the calf we were fattening and has prepared a great feast to celebrate his coming home again unharmed.' The older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came out and begged him, but he replied, 'All these years I've worked hard for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to do. And in all that time, you never gave me even one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet when this son of yours comes back after spending your money on prostitutes, you celebrate by killing the finest calf we have in the place. Look, dear son, his father said to him, you and I are very close, and everything I have is yours. But it is right to celebrate, for he is your brother, and he was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and is found. Here ends the reading.
So, last week we talked about some of the different characters in the scripture, and we tried to place ourselves somewhere in the story. We reflected mainly on the younger son and the sinners that were sitting at that table with Jesus. And we thought about the grace offered to them and received. But we also asked very briefly, what would it have been like to be a scribe or a Pharisee? To have worked really hard, to have studied and earned degrees. I mean, could I imagine what it would be like to be the kind of person who has played by the rules all my life, that I was responsible, hardworking, that I took my faith very seriously? And along the same lines, could I imagine then what it would be like to be an older brother who had also always worked hard, was always dependable? And then, what would it be like to have a younger brother who had wasted all of my father's hard-earned money and then come crawling back, begging for more? Could I imagine how that would feel? Now, I think most of us could at least picture that. And then, to see our father throw a party for this selfish son with music and dancing and killing the fatted calf. Can I imagine any resentment? You know, I have a friend who placed himself in the shoes of the older brother. He had always been a Christian, grew up Christian, and as he got older, though, he found himself becoming more and more judgmental. Judgmental of people who didn't share his point of view, who didn't live up to kind of his standards of Christianity, who didn't seem to take it quite as seriously as he did. But also, he became more and more judgmental of people outside the faith and people with no faith. And not overtly, but in his heart. And he shared with me one morning that he was reading this parable and it just dawned on him that he was that older brother. And he felt convicted. And he said, I realized that I would work really hard in the church and I would give very generously. But then resent it. I would wonder why others weren't working that hard or giving that much, and that resentment built over time. And there was no joy. He said, you know, in the parable, the younger son, his being lost is more obvious. I mean, he messed up really bad. But, you know, the older brother, he's lost too. He did all the right things. He was obedient, hardworking, and I imagine that people really respected and admired him. Outwardly, he was faultless. But in here, there was anger, bitterness, resentment, judgment, condemnation. I mean, all attitudes that are so damaging to the human heart, and it kept him far from the Father. You know, I don't think my friend is alone in identifying with the older brother. Last week I shared with you some from Henry Nouwen's book, The Return of the Prodigal. And in that book, he too says he identifies maybe more with that older brother. He returns to the image of Rembrandt's painting. And if you remember the painting, the younger son, he's in tattered clothes and he's kneeling in the warm embrace of his forgiving father. But then just off to the side, we have the older brother pictured standing there, very stern looking. And he's watching the father embrace his prodigal son. He appears very withdrawn. He's looking at his father, but not with joy. Nouwen writes, "When I listen carefully to the words with which the elder son attacks his father, self-righteous, self-pitying, jealous words, I hear a deeper complaint. It's the complaint that comes from the heart that feels it never received what it was due. It's a complaint expressed in countless subtle and not so subtle ways, forming a bedrock of human resentment. It was a complaint that cries out, I tried so hard, worked so long, did so much, and I still have not received what others get. Why do people not thank me and not invite me, not play with me, not honor me, while they pay so much attention to those who take life so easily and casually? If you think about it, resentment does tell me that I don't get what I deserve. Resentment, it keeps me from noticing all that I do have. And it keeps me closed off from that grace that has been also so clearly extended also to me. Now, when we feel like we have to be the judge of the world, when we feel like we have to keep score, who's done what, who hasn't, who's in, who's out, who's serious, who's not, it just begins to feel like a burden. We begin to feel less free, less spontaneous, less playful, less joyful, and more heavy. I mean, the truth is, resentment and joy cannot coexist. Now I notice that in the shoes of the older brother, in some cases, there can be a serious, moralistic intensity, even a touch of fanaticism that makes it increasingly difficult to feel at home in the father's house. He writes, returning home from a lustful escapade as the younger son did seems so much easier than returning home from a cold anger that has rooted itself in my deepest part of my being. And yet, I know that the father not only wants his younger son back, he wants the older son back as well. So how do I return? Well, here's a thought. Can I take a leap of faith? A leap of faith to love without expecting to be loved in return. A leap of faith to give without ever expecting to receive, to invite without expecting to be invited, to hold without expecting to be held. And can I trust that just as the Father's love extends to the prodigal, so too it extends just as richly, just as deeply to me? So Jesus, he was clearly telling a story about who God is, and it's a story about undeserved grace. But it leaves us with an open ending, doesn't it? Now remember, Jesus was telling the story in response to the complaint of the Pharisees and the scribes. I mean, they're grumbling about him sitting with the tax collectors and the sinners. And he tells them a story not only about a younger son who went astray and came home, but also a story about a resentful older brother. And they are left to choose for themselves how they will respond. Will they join Jesus at the table with these outsiders? Will they enter into the joy of the Father? Will we? You know, when the older son, he returns from his hard day of work, the party's in full swing. I mean, the music and the dancing are there. And we're left with the elder brother standing outside, just refusing to come in. Do you ever wonder what happened? Will he let himself be persuaded by the Father? Is he willing to be found? Is he willing to confess that he too is a sinner in need of forgiveness? Is he willing to open his heart? We don't know. But what I do know, beyond any shadow of a doubt, is the heart of the Father. It is a heart of mercy. It is a heart of grace. My prayer for you today is that when you find yourselves in the shoes of the older brother, or maybe the older daughter, may you remember that the Father's love for you, as it is for all his children, is unconditional. There is nothing you need to do to earn that grace, that love. May you be willing to accept that love. May you be willing to kneel down, maybe again or maybe for the first time, and allow God to embrace you. And may you hear the words, "My child, you are always with me. All that I have is yours. Come, share in my joy. Come, share in my love for others. Come, accept my love for you." May it be so. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in the affirmation of faith. What do you believe when you confess your faith in God the Father Almighty? That God is God of love, and that God's love is powerful beyond measure. What do you affirm when you confess your faith in Jesus Christ as our Lord? That having been raised from the dead, he reigns with compassion and justice over all things in heaven and earth, and that by loving and serving others, above all else, we give glory and honor to God. What do you believe when you confess your faith in the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit is the personal bond by which Jesus Christ unites us to himself, the teacher who opens our hearts to Christ, and the comforter who leads us to repentance, empowering us to live in Christ's service. What do you affirm when you speak of the life everlasting? That communion with Jesus Christ is eternal life itself. To him we are joined by the Holy Spirit through faith. And as adopted as children, the sons and daughters of God. Through him we are raised from death to new life. For with him we shall live to all eternity.
Almighty God, in you we live and move and have our being. You are the source of all goodness and light and love. We praise you, and we thank you for the wealth of blessings in our lives and in our church. Today, we come to you as a people who need healing. As a nation, we are deeply divided. We ourselves have seen families torn apart, friendships ended. Our fears and our anxieties run deep. We do remember today our unity in Christ, and we claim that unity. For we know, O God, that you are one, and that you desire for us to be one. Open our hearts to one another and to you. Heal us. Redeem us, bless us, that together we would be a blessing. We pray now for our nation's leaders, asking you to bend their hearts and their wills toward your will. Disarm any evil at work, and bring them and us to a place of humility and submission to your lordship. We have other needs on our hearts, O God. We pray for those who are sick and suffering, especially those with the coronavirus, others who are recovering from surgery, others still battling loneliness or depression. We lift up to you these and other concerns now in the next moment of silence. All-loving, all-gracious God, empower us whom you have called to be your people, your church. Empower us to live up to our ideals, to embody the forgiveness and love we've received, that we might witness to your love and grace. Together, we pray now in Jesus' name the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you'd like to make an offering, there are one of two ways you can do that. You can always just go on our website, and on the front page there is a link to give. If you follow that link, it's very simple. And of course, you can always just mail a check into the church office. Our weekly offerings are the means by which our worship and all of our ministry and mission happen. And we give in response to God's love and mercy and grace.
The birds they sang at the break of day. Start again, I heard them say. Don't dwell on what has passed away or what is yet to be. Yeah, the wars, they will be fought again. The holy dove, she will be caught again. Bought and sold and bought again, the dove is never free. Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. You won't have the sum. Strike up the march, but there is no drum. Every heart to love will come, but like a refugee. Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. That's how the light gets in. That's how the light gets in.
Generous God, bless and multiply these tithes and offerings so that your ministry and mission through us would touch lives, change hearts, and deepen discipleship. In Christ's name, amen.
Just reward of labor, God. God's will be done. In the help we give our neighbor, God's will be done. In our worldwide task of caring for the hungry and despairing, in the harvests we are sharing, God's will be done. For the harvests of the Spirit, thanks be to God. For the good we all inherit, thanks be to God. For the wonders that astound us, for the truths that still confound us, most of all that love has found us, thanks be to God.
My prayer for you again today is this. I pray that you would accept God's grace, God's love for you in the very deepest part of your being. And may the love, the compassion, the forgiveness that you yourself have received also be a gift that you have to share with the world around you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Go in peace. Amen.